जाए। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरोन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वापदान्तिकं। वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपदां सगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। हे कृष्णा करुणा सिंधो दीनाबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिकाकांत राधाकांत नमोस्तुते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभयेव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। कूजन्तं राम रामेति मधुरं मधुराक्षरं आरोह्य शाखां वन्दे वन्दे वाल्मीकिकोकिलम्। आपदावतारं दादारं सर्वसंपदां लोकाभिरामं श्रीरामं भूयो भूयो नमाम्यहं। श्रीराम राम रामेति रमे रामे मनोरमे सहस्रनाम तत्तुल्यं राम नाम वरानमे। सर्वाइष्टनिवारकं शुभकरं पिंगलाशमापकं सीतान्वेषणा तत्परं कविवरं कोटीन्द्रसूर्यप्रभं लंकाधीपभयंकरं सकलपं सुग्रीवसम्मानिदं देवेन्द्रादिसमस्तदेवनिदं काकस्तूतं भजे। ज्ञातः श्रीरामदूतः पवनतनुभवः पिंगलाहशिखावान् सीताशोकापहारी दशमुखविजयी लक्ष्मणप्राणनाथा। आनेदां वेचजात्रे लवणचलनिदे लंगने दीशद्दोर्योयः वीरः श्रीमान् हनुमान् मम मनसि वसन्। कार्यसिद्धिं तनोदु मनोचपं मारुततुल्यवेगं जितेन्द्रियां बुधिबुधां वरिष्ठं वादात्मजं वानरयूथमुख्यं श्रीरामदूतं शिरसा नमामि। बुद्धिर्बलं यशोधैर्यं निर्भयत्वं अरोगता अजाट्यं वाक्पटुत्वं च श्री हनुमत्स्मरणात् भवेत्। जय श्रील प्रभुपाद। So welcome everyone to the final lecture of Balakanda. In fact, there are more devotees who have joined in new. I welcome one and all who has been joining regularly, at the same time who have been joining at the shortest invitation that we have extended. Thank you very much for taking out time on this Sunday on Ekadashi and extending the beautiful Shravana Yajna, as we call it, the Yajna or the process by which our heart actually melts and our heart actually naturally goes towards the Lord. That's the Shravana Yajna, and it is highly encouraged during Ekadashi that we hear more and more pastimes of the Lord. So we saw today at 11 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. the beautiful pastime of how Vishwamitra, accompanied by Lord Ramchandra and Lakshmana, after killing Tataka, they got all the missiles, all the different kind of weaponry. We saw how Vedanta Deshika mentioned their quivers were full of those weapons with the feathery tips of different colors, and it was bobbling along with their heads as they were walking in the forest. It gave a wonderful resplendent feature of as if the Adishesha was actually on the top of the Lord and the Lord was walking in front. We also saw his narration in Gautama Ashrama and Ahalya's deliverance. We slowly also saw the pastimes of Mother Ganges and Upendra, who is none other than Vamandev. We saw the glories of the lotus feet of the Lord, and those lotus feet of the Lord are going one on one together with Lakshmana, and both the princes have now entered the kingdom of Mithila. That's where we stopped, and that's where we have to continue. So today we will complete the Balakanda with the marriage of Mother Sita and also Lord Ramchandra. So without further ado, let's go ahead and see this pastime unfurl in front of us. One of my humble requests is that these pastimes are not to be just heard. The Acharyas mention that when these pastimes are actually said in a very nice way, in fact, I am not reciting them in a nice way. There are many wonderful reciters of Ramayana. When it is actually recited in the most pure form, you can actually see the canvas in front of you. It will be like a direction of Ramayana. It will be unfurled in front of you. You will be transported yourself to that place, and the real emotions of whatever is going on or pervading at that particular scene would be also entering our hearts. Such is the capability of Ramayana. Such is the capability of the purports given by our Acharyas. And such is the wonderful capability of Valmiki himself, who has chosen pearl-like text and words to describe the greatest form and to describe the greatest activities of the Lord himself. So this is the great science behind it. So it's my humble request that when you are actually listening to this, try to envisage or try to see the wonderful pastime as if you are transported there. For some time, forget that you are in the lockdown. Get involved into the katha and try to keep your distractions minimum so that you will relish. I hope that we all will, at the end of the lecture, relish ourselves in such a way that we will also would like to get an invitation card for that great marriage. So with that, let us go back to the scene where we saw Vishwamitra along with the wonderful two resplendent princes of Kosala kingdom are taking their nano steps towards the Mithila Nagari. All the Mithila Vasis, they are of a different appearance than the appearance of Kosala kingdom, as they are near the Himalayas, near the Janakapuri and the Nepals, and in the Bharatavarsha. They have little shorter eyes, but at the same time, Valmiki says it is the place where Mother Sita is there, who has Vishala Akshi. That means she has very large eyes, very beautiful eyes, and those eyes extend up to the ear, and they are very beautiful to look at. So that is the place of Mithila, and it is also called as Vaidehi kingdom. And the king of that place is Siradhwaja, who is none other than also called as King Janaka. Janaka is known for his meritorious character. The place Valmiki mentions is Janaka is such a great personality that many, many people come to Janak to take opinion of what is dharma and what is adharma. In fact, he is the personality, one of the greatest, that he actually tells that what should be done correctly and what should be the righteous path in executing service to that great kingdom. Just like Ayodhya, people used to also visit Janak Maharaj. So Janak Maharaj was a very pious king, and he also had a great set of ministers. His favorite minister or his favorite Kula Guru or his favorite spiritual master, just like for Dasharatha was Vasishta, here the person's name was Shatananda. So Vishwamitra knew all these sages and all these rishis and munis very well, because he was a well-known sage. Vasishta anyway knew him. We saw the story that Vasishta and Vishwamitra, how they fought together. This whole story was narrated by Vishwamitra himself to Lord Rama. And Vishwamitra wanted to meet Shatananda and give a good news. So at this time, when Vishwamitra was walking through the main grand street of Mithila towards the palace, all the people were looking at the sage. They were bowing down. They saw that this is a great opportunity for us to serve the sage. Because it said in the Vaishnava Acharya's literature that darshane pavitra karo yehi tumargun. So in that, the first verse is, it says गंगारा पराश होइले। सो व्हेन यू एक्चुअली टेक बाथ इन द गैंजेस यू गेट रिड अवे ऑफ ऑल द सिंस, बट दे से व्हेन अ ग्रेट पर्सनालिटी और अ ग्रेट डिवोटी इज सीन द सिंस आर ऑटोमेटिकली वॉश्ड अवे। सो दिस इज द ग्रेट क्वालिटी ऑफ अ डिवोटी बिकॉज ही हिमसेल्फ इज लाइक अ धाम, लाइक अ होली धाम, एंड ही इज कैरिंग द लॉर्ड विद इन हिज हार्ट। सो सीइंग द ग्रेट विश्वामित्र, एवरीबडी स्टार्टेड बोइंग डाउन and they offered their respectful obeisances. Vishwamitra looked at Lord Ramchandra and said, I have some official duty. Why don't you look at the bylanes of this Mithila kingdom, and why don't you come back? So Lord Ramchandra, he's always interested to knowing culture. He's a person who likes to vibe with the common people, at the same time keep his great position of him as the Kosala prince on behalf of Dasharath. He's just 12 years of age, along with Lakshman, with bows on their shoulder. They are walking through one by lane after the other. And as they were walking by through one by lane after the other, they took a left, they took a right. Some people looked at their resplendent faces. Some people thought it was the Ravi and the Soma, both the sun and the moon god, have appeared on the streets of Vaideha kingdom. Everybody were astonished. Some people who just opened their windows to sprinkle water outside their houses, they looked at both of them and they stopped. And at that same point of time, it was as if the camera has frozen completely. And Lord Ramchandra and Lakshmana, with a beautiful smile and their majestic gait, elephant-like walk, they just went by. And people then resumed their activities and they were like, okay, what just happened to us? This was such a beautiful walk of such two great princes who have just walked by. And they were taking turns, smiling at the Maidehi kingdom, admiring the entire Janakapuri, Mithilapuri as we call it. And they reached a place where there was a mezzanine floor. Generally, mezzanine floors are floors which has pillars, and it is on top of an existing architecture. At that place, there were a set of little girls, 6 to 7 years old. They were playing catch a ball. So they were having a ball made of flowers or made of different materials, and they used to throw, and the girls on the other side of the group used to catch it, and then they used to throw, and there used to be one person who used to make a score with the ink made of the flowers. And she used to write on that pad that what is the score, how many people dropped the ball, how many people caught the ball. So this entire picturesque scene was going on. Lord Ramchandra just walked into the street. At that time, the team A of girls threw the ball, and there was a small little girl, 6-year-old. She missed catching the ball. The ball hit her hand. It fell down on the mezzanine floor, and it fell down on the parapet of that mezzanine floor. It fell down on the street, and just like a ball does, it started rolling. When it started rolling, it slowly, as it rolled, it came and hit the lotus feet of Lord Ramchandra. And Lord Ramchandra saw that there is a ball which is actually hitting his feet. And he was thinking, how come this bylanes were generally empty, and how come this ball is hitting my feet, and who is the one who is playing? So immediately he knew that this came from the upward direction. So he looked up with his gentle eyes, and lotus-like eyes, it started looking up. And the girl who had actually dropped it saw the ball roll down, and she wanted to go down and take it. And when she saw that there is a personality with shoes and armor, and at the same time is having the greatest clothes that she has seen that this person is wearing, she slowly looked up and looked at this personality. What shocked this girl was that she never sees such personalities in and around the bylanes of Mithila. Generally, they are seen near the palaces. They come to the palaces and go. Nobody comes to the bylanes. But here there is a personality very beautiful. And when she looked up, both their eyes met each other, and both of them looked at each other. And Valmiki says that little girl was none other than Mother Sita. She was just merely 6 years of age, but she had the full Karunamayi eyes, the full of mercy. And this was the first sight between Lord Ramchandra and Mother Sita in the by lanes of Mithila. Immediately the girls recited and they went back. The scene cuts itself. Valmiki gives a very beautiful picture where he hangs us on a suspense of what happened next. For all the romantic people in the world, this was one of the most greatest scenes on the entire cosmic manifestation. All the devatas and everybody were happy looking at the way Lord Ramchandra looked at Mother Sita. Bollywood is eternally inspired by this very simple attribute, and they show it in many, many movies. But the originality of how Valmiki says, how Kamban says in Ramayana, all these are the very core essence of the very loving relationship between Lord Vishnu and Mother Lakshmi, who is none other than Lord Rama and Sita. The scene cuts from there, and the scene immediately transcends itself into the palaces where Vishwamitra is walking by. Vishwamitra is walking, everybody gets to stand up. Shatananda also stands up, the Kulaguru. He also welcomes Vishwamitra, tells in the ear of Janaka, he is Vishwamitra, one of the great sages, and I hear from my messengers that he has successfully completed the yajna in Siddhashrama, and after that he heard about the competition that we have kept. So what is about this competition? So the competition was just like at the age of 12 when Dasharatha was becoming very tensed of how Lord Rama will get married. Similarly, Janaka was also tensed that how will he give his daughter's hand in marriage to a suitable person. Back in those days, unlike the days today, in fact, where we are trying for equality and we are trying for getting the right feminine equality, back in those days, women had the maximum power. In fact, they had the choice to choose their husband. It is not that it was a forced arrangement. It was the Kshatriya nature of Swayamvara, where she could choose the husband. And she would not choose anybody who walked in through the door. She would choose a person who is valorous. At the same time, she would choose a person who is dharmic in nature, who follows in the path of Dharma. So there was a big competition kept by Janaka Maharaj, by Janaka the king, that there was a great bow which came from his ancestral lineage. This bow was used by none other than Lord Shiva himself. It was called as the Mahesh Chapa. And this bow was such a great bow that it came from Lord Shiva. In fact, the history says there was a great battle supposed to happen between Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu. So Lord Shiva came with all his arsenal, all his inventory of weapons. Lord Vishnu came in Garuda. Sometimes they sport like this, the demigods, they sport like this. But Lord Vishnu also wanted to fight with his devotee. So they both came. So Lord Shiva was ready. Lord Vishnu was ready. And at that time, Lord Vishnu just gave out a breath. He just did. And when he actually gave out a breath, it was called as Humkara. When he did give the Humkara, the very bow by which Lord Shiva was supposed to fight, it formed a small hairline crack on that bow. And because there was a hairline crack, now it was a deformed weapon. Lord Shiva did not want to fight. The fight was called off. In fact, the fight never happened. So that bow, which actually Lord Shiva carried and which was broken by Lord Vishnu himself, that was given in lineage one after the other to none other than Janaka. It was coming down the ancestral lineage, and here they were kept in the Janaka's court. And it was said that anybody who wants to win the hand of Mother Sita, there is a Swayamvar which is going to happen, and this Swayamvar's message comes to everybody. And it came to Vishwamitra also, because Vishwamitra back in those days was known for marrying many people. He was married to Ramba, he was married to Menaka, he was married to Tilottama, he was married to Urvashi. Like that, he was married to many people. And this time when the message came, he already was a Brahmarishi. He said, I don't want to marry anybody else, but there is a suitable person who is called as Ramachandra. And he started giving the entire lineage of Ramachandra, saying that who Ramachandra is, where is he coming from, what is the Kosala kingdom. And both the people were sitting and listening. Who are the two people? None other than Janaka and his royal priest, who is none other than Shatananda. they both were listening. They were like, okay, fine. So what? Okay, he's Ramchandra. So what? What happened? So Vishwamitra thought that I am explaining such greatness. Maybe these people have not known his greatness. So it is time for me to explain something very unique, which will catch their attention. This is the quality of a good speaker. A good speaker, when he is actually speaking to his audience, he should know what will catch his audience. What is the rasa that the audience would like? What is the beautiful thing that they would like to hear? And if somebody shows a little interest, flaming that interest a little more, flaming that passion a little more, and in that passion, putting the ghee of Krishna rasa, putting the ghee of Rama rasa, becomes the most beautiful fire that you can enlit in the core of the heart. And that fire will catch itself and it will become so wonderful, and it is cooling at the same point of time because of the blessings of the holy name. So a good speaker knows the right subject to speak about. And here Vishwamitra was speaking on that subject matter, and he introduced the topic that seems like you guys do not know the prowess of Ramachandra. I would like to speak to Shatananda and I would like to tell you a small narration of how great Ramchandra is. He said, yeah, please tell me what is his greatness. He said, have you heard the name Ahalya? And Shatananda really got shocked. He said, how, what kind of question is this? I am the son of Ahalya. I am the son of Gautama Rishi and Ahalya, and my name is Shatananda. Yes, my mother, I know about her plight. She is being turned into a stone or has become invisible by the curse of my father, Gautama Rishi. So she is there. So what about her? What has happened to her? Is she fine? He said, she is absolutely fine because her curse was broken by none other than the Padambuja Rajasaha, which is from the lotus feet of Lord Ramchandra, the dust that fell on Ahalya. So when Shatananda heard that her mother is actually well, he himself could not take her out of the curse, and here is that person, there was an immediate connect. So it is said that Vishwamitra put the bomb at the right place and it started, and everybody were happy because everybody in Mithilapuri knew that Ahalya was there for 10,000 years as a proper lockdown. So this was the time when the lockdown came out and everybody was rejoicing. Shatananda said, very well, very well. We have tomorrow the beautiful Swayamvara. Why don't you call Ramchandra himself to come? So the next day, the beautiful scene was set. The palace was resplendent with a lot of kings who have got these invitations. Many kings from many provinces had come from far and wide to the Mithila kingdom. They had heard about the beauty of Mother Sita. So a court attendant came and he spoke about the glories of Mother Sita. And he said Sita was none other than Mother Earth's child, who was received by Sirat Dwaja, who is now known as Janaka. And that Janaka Maharaj was actually one day plowing the field, and with the plow, he was plowing the field and he was thinking that I should get a beautiful daughter. And when he was thinking that I should get a beautiful daughter, the plow immediately hit a trunk which got stuck in the sand. And because it was a plow, in Sanskrit, the plow is called as Tasi. And because it is inverted in nature, the name was kept as Sita. So this is the beautiful name of Mother Sita. She came from Bhuma Devi. We actually saw in the first Uttarakanda that how Valmiki, who is also coming from Mother Earth, who is actually coming from the termite called Valmikam, are brother to Mother Sita, who is also coming from Mother Earth. So her beauty was explained in the court. Everybody were enchanted by Mother Sita's beauty. Everybody wanted to have a chance of breaking the bow, and everybody wanted a chance to win the hand of Mother Sita. Many, many people were waiting for an opportunity by which they can win over Mother Sita's hand in this Swayamvara. Janaka was very much anxious. He knew the task in front of them. Because Mother Sita, once what she did is, this bow of Lord Shiva cannot be easily lifted. Once it is said that Parashuram, he used to come and visit all the kshatriyas and see that who is actually ruling the kingdom properly and who is not ruling the kingdom properly. So he came to many places, and one day what Parashuram, when he came, he kept his bow outside the gate and he wanted to meet Janaka, and he was discussing with Janaka. At that time, Mother Sita was a small baby. She was just crawling by. And there was this great bow of Lord Shiva, which is called the Mahesha Chapa. It was kept there in a big casket. And it, Valmiki says that casket had around 16 different wheels. And to push it, it needed at least 5,000 different people with strong bodied men. Not people like me who try to push it. Strong bodied muscle men used to push it. And then it would move an inch in half an hour. So that was the great casket and the Mahesha Chapa bow. And Parashuram was discussing with Dasharath. And at that time, Mother Sita was playing with the ball, and the ball went below the casket. And she wanted to take the ball, and she was asking Janak Maharaj that, please give me this ball. And Janak Maharaj was discussing avidly with none other than Parashuram. At that time, Mother Sita said, these people won't help me. Let me help myself. So with one hand, she lifted the casket. She is actually the daughter of Mother Earth. How is it difficult for Mother Earth to lift anything that is on Mother Earth? In fact, Mother Earth is the one who is lifting all of them. But Mother Earth says she can lift the entire Earth many times over. She can take the weight of many people, but only thing that she cannot bear the weight is of one sinful person who tells a lie. So we should be very careful that we should not lie, because Mother Earth feels the maximum burden of a sinful person who lies. So here, Mother Sita, she lifted with her lotus hand the beautiful casket and Mahesha Chapa, and coolly she took the ball and she kept it back and she went away. Parashuram was actually stunned. He saw that this little girl has got so much of Shakti. This little girl has got so much of energy. This little girl has got so much of strength. Somebody of a great valor and somebody who is a great personality should be the one who should be marrying this girl. So with that said, Janaka Maharaj on that day itself, he had decided that a person who can actually take this bow and string it and then win the Swayamvara, only that person will get Mother Sita's hand. He, after reciting all these wonderful qualities of Mother Sita, Janak Maharaj told the assembly and told those muscle men and those bodyguards to bring the Mahesha Chapa into the assembly. The scene cuts from there when they were actually bringing. At that very time, Vishwamitra, Rama and Lakshmana also enter into the palace. This is given. Everybody is looking towards the left, waiting for the Mahesh Chapa. But before that, the person himself in the previous lifetimes who caused a hairline crack on that Mahesh Chapa, they are entering. Sumanga Vadyagha, all the beautiful instruments started playing by the musicians on the entry of different kings. At that time, everybody missed a note because they were looking at the beauty of Lord Ramchandra. And everybody were looking at the beauty of Lord Ramchandra. On the top floor were all the girls who were sitting with Mother Sita. A beautiful poet gives a very nice rendition. She also wanted to see Lord Ramchandra. This is the interest that Mother Sita had, because she had already seen him once as a person who stopped her ball in the bylanes of Mithila. So she wanted to see, but in the Vedic custom, the girl would not see directly the eyes of a boy. So Mother Sita actually was talking to her friends and she said, do you know that why my bangle is actually very loose today? She used to say like that, and she used to put her hand outside the balcony so that the bangles will fall from her hand, it will fall down. So everybody will look at the bangle. While she is looking at the bangle, she will look down on Lord Ramchandra. So this was a small excuse that Mother Sita used to give. She was a very smart lady. She was so smart and she was so cute in her dealings that she would actually clang her bangles and the bangles would fall on her wrists. And she would say, have you seen my bangles? They are pretty new. And with that, while everybody is looking at the bangle, she would steal a glance of Lord Ramchandra. So she also noticed that Lord Ramchandra was there. Lord Rama took the seat next to Vishwamitra. He bowed down to Janaka and also Shatananda, but he as a prince took the seat. Then 5,000 different people brought the great Mahesha Chapa inside, and it was squeaking, and so many people were pulling, they were sweating, and finally they came and they kept the bow right in the center of the palace of Mithila. And Janaka said, let the Swayamvara begin. Many kings and people came and tried their hand, but they could not even, some people could not even open the casket. Some people could not even touch the bow. Some people could not even lift the bow, forget about stringing it completely. Lord Ramchandra was sitting there. He was actually not interested to do anything at that time, because he was not told to do anything. The rule that was given to him was by his father, that obey the instructions of Vishwamitra. At that time, Vishwamitra saw that time is very opportune. This is the time for everybody to know the valor of Lord Ramachandra. So at that time, Vishwamitra immediately said this beautiful verse, Pashya, Pashya, Pashya Vatsaha. So when he says Pashya, means please see, O Vatsa. Vatsa means young boy. So when he said young boy, the first person who got up was Lakshmana, because the duty bound Lakshmana, he always thought that when a boy has been called, okay, there are two boys here, one is my elder brother and one is my younger brother, one is I who am the younger brother, but my elder brother is not supposed to do any work. I am the one who is supposed to do the work. So for sure the spiritual master would have called my name so that I can serve Lord Ramchandra. So when he says Pashyavatsa Ramaha, he didn't say Rama, he said Pashyavatsaha. Pashya, please see, O boy. Lakshmana got up. Vishwamitra said, oh my God, now the whole Ramayana is going to change. If this boy goes and picks it up, he will easily pick it up himself as well, because he is Anant Shesh himself. He picks up the whole world on top of his head. Now if Lakshmana goes and picks up the bow and breaks the bow, the Ramayana will turn in itself. So immediately he added the word, the Supraja Rama, which he uses in Kausalya Supraja Rama. He said, Vashya Pashyavatsa Ramaha. Rama, you please go and see. Now, Lord Ramchandra is not a common boy like you and me and many others in our houses. If we tell our children, please go and see, they will immediately go and they will say, Papa, I looked at somebody who is outside, and they will come back. If there is cha-cha, cha-chi, kaka, kaki, they will not even open the door. Because what was the instruction? The instruction was, go outside and see who it is there. So they are very obedient. They will open, they will see, and they will come back and report. But Lord Ramchandra was not like that. In fact, Ayodhya, remember in the previous lecture that I mentioned, Ayodhya Vasis had a very special quality in themselves. They could communicate with their eyes. It is said that best are the people who are actually able to communicate within their eyes. Now we are in a virtual session. We are not able to communicate that well with the eyes. But generally when we give lectures, we can actually see the audience, they communicate with their eyes. They say many things communicate with their eyes. They mention how the entire activities of entire activities, whatever they want to say, they will say it with their eyes. The husband will say the same thing to the wife. They will say that, let's go, time's up. They will not say this in words. They will say, the wife will sometimes say to the husband, take the medicine. All these things are said by the eyes, right? So all these communications are with the eyes, and this communication happens. Only some people who do not understand, they will come and tap the wife and said, what did you say? Oh, I actually said this. I actually said that. So this eye communication was excellent for Kosala Nagar Vasis. And for Ayodhya Vasis, this was a natural talent. So when Vishwamitra said, Pashya Rama, he didn't say it like that. He said, Pashya Rama. He actually lifted his eye. See, that's the beauty of Valmiki Ramayan. Even the eye movement is very beautifully explained by Vishwamitra. How else can you explain the science of Valmiki Ramayana if there is no canvas in front of you, if that entire scene is not coming in front of us? He said, Pashyaramaha. And he said, please see. And with that, his eyes slowly lifted above. That means, Lord Rama, go and pick up the bow and see it. So Lord Ramchandra understood this very well, and he started to get up and he started to walk. Acharyas say, when he actually started walking, many people knew that he will lift it. Now, this is called the gait shastra, the shastra of how a person walks. If we send a person to do a job, by the way they actually come back after doing that job, we get to know whether they are successful in their work or they are failure in their work. For example, if you tell somebody as a husband, go and get milk from the store during lockdown, the way they will come and hit the bell, you will get to know whether they got the milk or they didn't get the milk. It's very easy to know if the shoulders droop, if the eyes are looking down, then people know that the activity is actually a defeat. But if they are looking up and they are swinging their bags with the packet of milk, that means they have been successful. They dodged the police, they went to the general store and got the milk packet. So by the gait in itself, you can get to know how wonderfully the activity has been performed. So when Lord Ramchandra got up, it was very clear that he is going to pick up the bow. And he started walking briskly towards the Mahesha Chapa. He circumambulated the casket once and he directly placed his hand on the middle of the Mahesha Chapa. He picked it up and he saw the string. And when he picked it up, he didn't pick it up slowly. He just jerked as if he's picking up a small twig from Mother Earth. He's compared that just like an elephant with its trunk would just pick a twig from the tree. That's how he picked up the great Mahesha Chapa, which was pulled by 5,000 different people, and he kept his toe on the bottom half of the bow, and he started stretching the string with his hand with the aim of tying it on the top. By this scene itself, everybody were shocked. Some people fell down from their thrones and they said, so many people have tried, and here is a person who has actually lifted the bow and he's now stretching it. Before he even could do the pratyancha, that means he could do the aropana, or he could tie the string to the bow started creaking, and from the hairline fracture that it was already there, it started to break and it broke with a loud sound. The sonic boom of the sound burst out through the assembly hall, and it is said that even the devas and the shrutiganas and the gandharas and everybody heard this reverberation of this bow, and it was broken, and this humkara was heard everywhere, and some people kept both their hands on their ears. They couldn't bear the sound. But here, Rama was standing there, unfettering, unmoving, and he was smiling that what kind of bow? I wanted to put a string to it. It broke. Janaka's anxiety went away in a flash with that sound. He was superiorly happy because he was thinking there will be nobody on this planet Earth who will be actually taking the hands of his daughter. At that time, Mother Sita got the cue, and the cue was to bring the garland and put it on the chest of Lord Ramchandra. Mother Sita was very happy. She immediately came and she was having the garland in her lotus-like hands, and she was about to put the garland on Ramchandra's neck. Immediately, Ramchandra said, stop. And everybody were looking at Ramchandra, and they were like, what happened? And Mother Sita was shocked. Now, what did I do? Or what is the mistake that I have done? Why is he telling me to stop? And Lord Ramchandra said, look, the instruction by my spiritual master was to see the bow. That's the only instruction that I have got. There was no mention of marriage. There was no mention that I should accept my hand. I should be accepting you. You will put a garland on me. These are not told by my spiritual master. My spiritual master said, go and look at the bough. I looked at it. I picked it up. I tried. It seems like an old twig. It broke in itself. Hence, this marriage and all, I cannot talk about it. You should talk to my elders. You should talk to my father. You should talk to my spiritual master first. Mother Sita was the most happy person at that time, it is said by Valmiki. You know why? Because this was the first time that Mother Sita first saw that she immediately thought this personality called Lord Ramchandra would be very valorous. He will be great personality who can fight over many, many battles. But this is the first time he actually spoke Dharma as well. So here is a husband who is actually valorous. At the same time, he is the one who is following the Dharma of following the spiritual master. She was very happy by the negation of marriage by Lord Ramchandra. Vishwamitra immediately stood up. Janaka stood up. Vishwamitra said, "Do not worry. I give you the permission. You can put the garland. But at the same time, Janaka, take the best of the horses. Give it to your messengers. Let them travel towards the east. Let them cross the Sarayu River as quickly as possible. 4 days, 5 days it will take. Let them send the message to Dasharatha." And Janaka was saying, "I am so happy. This is my daughter Sita. And along with Sita, this is a Jodi offer. Just like how Rama, whenever he comes with Vishwamitra, there is 1+1 offer. Similarly, I have another daughter who is known as Sumitra. She is also the sister. So she will be also married to Lakshmana." So immediately both the sons' marriage happened. At that time, there was another person in the kingdom. It was Janaka's younger brother, who was known as Kushandaja, and he had two other daughters whose name was Mandavi and Shrutakirti, and they also decided then and there, let us give the hands of Mandavi to Bharata and let us give the hands of Shrutakirti to Shatrughna. So all the four marriages were decided. Seems like it was the cost-cutting days during Mithila. But Vasishta and Shatananda said, whatever might be the cost cutting, we have to do four marriages. So we will take the dakshina of all the four marriages. Janaka had no problem. Dasharatha had no problem. So all these messengers went in a Vayu Marga. Actually, it is said that they went in such a fast way. The horses were driven. They went to Dasharatha. Dasharatha was twiddling his thumbs, waiting for Lord Ramchandra and Vishwamitra to come back. At this point of time, the messengers enter the kingdom of Ayodhya and they see that the flags are bearing the Mithila and the Vaidehi kingdom. Ayodhya Vasis are thinking, maybe it's a war. What is the message? They are waiting eagerly to know what the message is. And these messengers tell the news of how Lord Ramchandra came and he was victorious in Siddhashrama and how he did the pastime of Ahalya and how he broke the great Mahesha Chapa bow. At that time, Dasharatha started looking at Vasishta, who was just standing next to him. And he asked Vasishta, "Vasishta, is this the good thing that you said which will happen to Lord Rama?" Vasishta said, "Yes, this is the good thing. Let us carry everything. Let us start now, because 4 days it will take us to reach the beautiful palace of Vaidehi kingdom. Call Bharata, call Shatrughna, call all the musicians, call all the sages, call all the Rajagaddis, call all the Raja Purohitas, and with all the kumkum, this Shubham, all the beautiful ornaments, let us travel towards Mithila, or let us travel towards Janakpuri, where Mother Sita and Lord Rama is staying." They travel this entire entourage, reaches none other than Janakpuri. And at Janakpuri, they are getting a royal welcome. And everybody is informed about the four great marriages which is going to happen. And in this marriage, there is a beautiful place where Valmiki, and there is a beautiful tradition which had started. I would like to speak a few words about this beautiful tradition. This tradition was, whenever the girl's side or the boy's side they meet, they actually talk about their ancestral lineage. And this ancestral lineage is important to understand, that not only the boy or the girl, whether they are good or bad. I am saying all this because nowadays it's seen in a very bad light, arranged marriages. In fact, arranged marriages were the most beautiful scientific way of marriage, where the boy's side and the girl's side will be taught very clearly what is the lineage, what is that they are entering into, what's the mood of spiritual service in that particular lineage of ancestors, who are there on this side, who are there on the other side, who are the sons and the daughters, what did they do, and what are the ancestors and pitras activities. This enables to understand the spiritual depth of the ancestry and the lineage. And this was very beautifully done during those times. And even today, in the South Indian and the Dravidian marriages and in many other marriages up in the North and the West, when the astrologers meet, they actually talk about the Churnika. The Churnika is none other than the great speaking of this beautiful rendition of this pastime of the Lord, which is none other than speaking about what is the greatness, what is the beautiful greatness of the lineage of Lord Ramchandra. So Vashishta and Shatananda, they both started making the marriage card. And this marriage card was none other than the marriage card, the marriage invitation of Rama and Sita. So are you interested to know about what the marriage invitation had? Let me just read it out to you in pure Sanskrit. This beautiful Churnika, this beautiful narration of what was there in the marriage invitation card. In fact, it is said that if we hear just the marriage invitation card of Lord Ramchandra and Mother Sita, that itself gives us a so much cooling feeling in the heart, and it gives us spiritual bhakti. So this is the beautiful verses. Bear with me if I make some mistakes, because I just read it a couple of minutes back, but it's very, very beautiful that we should get to know what the Churnika is. And if you pay attention to the Sanskrit, you will very easily get the meanings of how Janaka came all the way from Ayodhya to Mithilapuri. Just close your eyes and listen to this beautiful shloka of Churnika. And whatever words you understand, just assimilate them. You will be able to see the canvas of how this entire entourage came from Ayodhya all the way to Mithilapuri. This is the Churnika. Ata janaka nrupatihi manorata maharnava paramagatva paramananda jaladau magnau jagat chakshu kulabhushanasya jagat traya dikshatasya natajana kalpataro shri kodanda diksha guru vivaha mahotsava shitirata varapurita bhagirata vamshajatam dasharata maharajam rata gaja turaga padadi sahitam samantri purohitam saputra kalatram sapara vivaramanya sakritya nanavida kramuka narikela ramadi fala yukta sahasra shata kumbha stambushite jambari charankanchite paripurna manoratha paramamoda phaura bhakta jana paraspara krita sallape sakala jana mahora lape. Now he talks about the ornaments. Kirita kundala kavacha keyura nupura mukta hara vibhushita nana vida mrudala chitranasta nana desha gata rajavarya brindalochana de. Now he talks about the ornaments which are brought by Indra. Nana vida swarna pushta stabaka koti dehi payamana malaya chandana guru. Chandan and aguru are the perfumes. Now he's talking about the perfumes. Chandana guru gugulu ghogrudatati parimala vasatu ghuma ghumayana sabantare nirantara mani kachita mukura parampare. Now he's talking about the musical instruments, and who is lining these musical entertainers? Beri mridanga maddala kahala duddu bituriya tumbura veena venu muraja maduka dindima damaru jalari jhara jhari dhavala shanka pavanava pataha ashtadasha vadya gosha santana santata shabdamana sakalandigantare narada timburu narada tumburu veenagana manohare. Who is leading the musicians? It is none other than Narada with the tumburu, with the veena. He doesn't stop there. Behind these musicians, who are there? They are the sages, सवत्स गो सहस्रदन्येक कोटि हिरण्य वस्त्राभरण भूडन भौमन संतोषित पत्रभूत उभया संबंधि राज श्रेष्ठ वंशावली नाम गोत्र प्रवोचरण निपुण वशिष्ठ वामदेव विश्वामित्र शतानंदी सकल मुनिगण संकीर्ण विवाह वेदि मध्ये कृत विविध स्तव सिद्धि महा ऋषि संगे महर्षि संगे विद एलोंग along the great rishis like Vashishta, Vamadeva, Vishwamitra, Shatanandi, Sakala Munigana, all the types of sages were assembled there. But the invitation was not sent to the musicians, not sent to the sages alone. The invitation was sent to all the places. And who are the other common people who joined? He says that as well. Ajabava, Vishnubava, Adityagana, Saptamrutyasha, तव शुक्र शगन सिदजन रुद्रगण मित्रकुलरत्न सुगुण स्तव समस्त प्रशस्त बिरुद्धोस्तम निनादे निरस्त धनेन्द्र बिरुदे ऑल द रुद्रास ऑल द सिद्धजनास ऑल द गंधर्वास एवरीबडी वेर इनवाइटेड फॉर दिस ग्रेट मैरिज एंड दे ऑल केम टुगेदर शंकर्षणाद्यमर बृंदाव किरमायण मंदर प्रमुख नंदावन कुसुम निवाह वर्ष नवरत्न खचित Kanaka Mantape. How is the Mantap created? Even that is mentioned. The Mantapas had very great creation where there were different types of ratnas which were embellished in those pillars. And they were bedecked with so many beautiful flowers. It was saying Kusuma Nivaha Varshe, as if the flowers were falling down like a varsha, like a rainfall. And Navaratna Kachita, Kanaka Kanmani Mantape. Kanmani Mantape means those had rubies, emeralds and lapis lazulis were embedded in the altar or in the stage of the wedding. And finally he says, Kinchidrapta Tarunyam Natajanaika Karunyam Vidalita Mahesha Chapam. That great person who broke the Mahesha Chapa, Vidhi Mukhasura Sura Vidita Prabhavam Parihuta Munijanatapam Bhanukula Ratna Deepam Sampurita Bhakta Janakamam Sakala dala jala jaladara shyamam sakala loka abhiramam shri ramam. So he says very beautifully, that person who broke the Mahesha Chapa, the Ratna Deepa, one who is actually the great personality of the Ishvaku lineage, the great personality of the Surya lineage, of the Surya Vamsha, he is Ratna Deepa, none other than Lord Rama, who is actually known as the greatest personality. This is the introduction and this is the mention of everything on top of the invitation card. And at the end, he's saying, Lokabhirama, Shri Rama. So that's when the word comes, Shri Rama. Below that comes Veds, W-E-D-S. And then comes none other than Mother Sita. So if you say only the boy's side, and if you don't say the girl's side, it's a problem. But do not worry. The Nepalis or the Janakpuri Vasis like to keep it short. Maybe they knew that time is running out for us to mention it. So they give a very beautiful description of Mother Sita as well. They say, Sannivesayaha. And you will see all the feminine qualities being described here. Whereas the valorous, the greatness, and all those qualities were described about the resplendence, the beauty, and the greatness of the Mantapa was mentioned in the upper description of the Ishvaku lineage. Whereas the beauty and the subtlety is actually mentioned in Mother Sita's verses. It says, Sannivesayaha Ketaki Champaka Mallika Kusuma Alankrita Neela Kalavenim Kalaham Sagamanim Karuna Valokinim Anargaman Manita Khachita Khema Kantim Nishka Kantim Hatakamaniniya Tataka Alankrita Kapolam Aganita Kalyana Gunashilam Aravinda Sundara Manda Hasa Mukhim Sri Raghunandin Abhimukhim Sitam Ya Chasanniveshayaha. So this is the final verses where it says Rama Veds Sita. Both the lineages are very beautifully explained, and when both the lineages are heard by such great personalities, they say that this is going to be a great marriage. The date was decided. It is said that even the astrology, gotras, everything doesn't match. In astrology, they say if the eyes match and they have a purutam, or they call it as if there is a match of the ice, and then the marriage is as good as to be done. So already Lord Ramchandra and Mother Sita had looked eye to eye, and this pastime had already happened when they were playing the ball. And there, after hearing this great description of this Churnika of on the both sides, immediately the date was set, and in that date Janak Maharaj came and he tapped on the shoulder of Lord Ramchandra and said the very great verse. It's one of the greatest verses in Balakandam. In fact, if the first verse of Ramayana is as great, then this verse spoken by Janaka is the epitome of verses in Balakanda. If we forget all the verses in Ramayana, but if we remember this shloka alone, this can give us the ultimate benefit of knowing, because this is the scene directly in Vaikuntha. And this is just handing over like a messenger of what is supposed to be happening eternally. The shloka that Janaka says, Iyam Sita Mama Suta Sahadharma Charitava Praticha Cha Inam Badram Te Panim Grihini Shapanina. Now, if I go into every word, Acharyas give 36 to 37 different meanings to this shloka. It's impossible to cover this one shloka alone. Can take 4.5 hours to explain, just to speak about what the glories is this shloka. But we will very shortly see what is the glory and what is Janak Maharaj saying. The first word she says, Iyam Sita, this Sita, whom I am actually holding the hand, Iyam Sita, Mama Suta. He's saying that this particular girl, Sita, is actually my child. Now, when he actually said that Sita is my child, no father will introduce her child like this. She'll say, she's my daughter. They will not say, this daughter is my daughter. Nobody will actually say like this. But there is an inner meaning why Janaka actually says this. Iyam Sita Mama Suta. This daughter, this girl whom you see is Mama Suta. Because there is two reasons. He has been like a foster father. He has been just maintaining Mother Sita. She was actually Bhumi Devi's daughter. And he has been taking care of Sita for this moment for 6 years to give it to Lord Ramchandra. So he's saying, this daughter whom I have been taking care, that is one meaning. But the other meaning of this is even more beautiful, because it says the great sage Yajnavalkya was another spiritual master of Janak Maharaj. Yajnavalkya always used to do a Zoom lecture, and he used to bring all his disciples together. And Yajnavalkya, if he saw that at 8:30 p.m. Janak Maharaj has not joined the Zoom lecture, he will wait. So when he used to wait, all the disciples used to ask, Guru Maharaj, why is that you are very partial to Janak Maharaj? If we don't come, you actually don't wait. But when Janaka does not come, you wait for some time. Seems like he gives you a lot of money, and that is the reason. So Yajnavalkya, the great sage, he thought that he should tell the disciples the greatness of Janaka. So one day when Janaka was also sitting and he was raptly hearing his spiritual master speak these words that we are not this body, but we are a spirit soul. At that time, the disciples were also hearing Yajnavalkya speak. Yajnavalkya, by his mystic power, he showed a scene in front of the disciples as an illusion that the entire Mithila kingdom was burning. When this scene, which is actually an illusion, which was shown in front of the disciples, all the disciples started running hither thither. They wanted to protect their gamchas. They wanted to protect their kamandalus. They wanted to protect their Bhagavad Gita book. Something or the other, they wanted to protect their mattresses. They wanted to protect their chatais. They wanted to protect their gulab jamuns, which they have kept in the pot. They started immediately dispersing from the lecture, and they started running here and there. But there was one personality who was sitting right there and still listening, not even perturbed by the entire episode. That person was none other than Janak Maharaj. And all the disciples, when they got to know that this was an illusion, they came back and fell down at the feet of spiritual master and said, why did you create this illusion? We thought our chatai was burning, our gulab jamun was getting stolen, our house was burning, we were running here and there. And Yajnavalkya said, why don't you ask Janaka? Janaka said, I need not move from here, because I knew that entire Mithila is also not mine. I might be the king, but it is not mine. Everything belongs to the Lord. I am not this body. I am just a spirit soul. So everybody understood that Janaka Maharaj never had this quality called this is mine or this belongs to me. He never had this ego at all. But look at the cut here. That Janak Maharaj who said this is not mine, he's here saying Mama Suta. She is actually mine. She is actually my daughter. So Vishwamitra also looked up and he was wondering that such a great personality called Janak who never said it is mine, but he is saying that this daughter Sita is mine. Because just look at the beauty of Mother Sita. She is the most beautiful person on this planet Earth or in this entire cosmic manifestation. So she is most beautiful. Who will actually say, looking at her beautiful face, that she is not mine? So out of Vatsalya, Janak Maharaj is saying, Iyam Sita, this Sita is actually Mama Suta. Another beautiful reason that the poets give is that when Lord Ramchandra actually looked at Mother Sita, and it is said in the Churnika that the mandapa is created with gems and rubies and everything. When Sita walked in, her reflection was there in all the gems and the rubies and the diamonds and the lapis lazulis which were there on the mandapa. And immediately you know that when you walk inside a mirror-like structure, your image is multiple times shown in those mirrors and these gems. So for a second, Lord Ramchandra could see millions of reflections of Mother Sita, and he was actually searching. All of them are beautiful. Where is the original Sita? So the tapping of the shoulder is saying, don't look here and there. That Sita what you are looking at is here. This is that Sita. Iyam Sita, Mama Suta. So this is also a very beautiful mention. So you can get to know the different perspectives. It's as if different cameras are kept at those places, and you can actually see those cameras and see different perspectives from Vishwamitra, perspectives from Lord Ramchandra. And then there is another explanation which is more beautiful, which is given by the Acharyas, which say, look at Iyam Sita Mama Suta. He's saying, oh Raghava, oh the Raghunandana, why don't you just have a look at my daughter? See how beautiful she is. Now, Ramchandra also knows that he is very beautiful because he has the Kaka Paksha Dharam Viram. He has the small hair-like strand, the jet black hairs, which are stretched and bound by Mother Kausalya, falls on his temple, and because of which Vishwamitra has recruited him. He also knows that he is very beautiful. So he asks Janata, what is so great in the beauty? So you say beautiful, beauty is there with anyone. Can you tell me about other qualities what she has? This is like saying, beauty, let it be on one side. Does it have beauty and brains? That's the question. You know what is the beautiful answer Janak Maharaj gives? Only that commodity need to be told of additional attributes if it is not saleable. It's like you are going to the market and you have a 10 rupees lunchbox. And it's a steel box or it's a plastic box. And for 10 rupees, if you actually see that lunch box or plastic box being advertised in the local trains of Mumbai, for 15 minutes, they will speak about how that lunch box is beautiful. How it opens from here, you can keep 20 things inside, it will keep it hot. He will go on saying millions of attributes. So Janaka is saying, my daughter is beautiful. That one attribute itself is enough. There is nothing else to sell because she is like a diamond. So when you actually talk about an uncut polished diamond, nobody needs to know other qualities, whether it conducts electricity, whether it is rare, nothing. The minute you say diamond, people are ready to purchase. That's the commodity that we are talking about. So he says, Iyam Sita Mama Suta, I need not talk about any other qualities of her. But since you asked, I will tell her. Sa Dharmachari Iva. She will walk by your dharma. If you walk in dharma's path, she will aid you towards dharma. If you walk in the adharma's path, she will be the person to bring you into dharma. So she knows dharma as well. Iyam Sita Mama Suta Saha Dharma Chari Tava Pratiche Cha Enam Bhadram Te. Why don't you take care of her? Now the Muhurta is going away. So why don't you actually catch her hand? Panim Grihini Shtva Panina. So this Pani Grahanam, which is actually called as holding of hands by the bride and the bridegroom, why don't you do this? And at that time, Lord Ramchandra holds the hand of Mother Sita. Vishwamitra is actually pouring the mantras and speaking the mantras. Janaka Maharaj is very happy that his daughter is getting married. At the same pandal, the next time Vashishta goes and speaks the next set of mantras, Sumitra is getting married to Lakshmana. In the next pandal, immediately Mandavi is getting married to Bharata. And in the next pandal, the beautiful Shrutakirti is getting married to Shatrughna. So all the four sisters, on cousin sisters and own sisters of Sita, Sumitra, Mandavi and Shrutakirti. Similarly, the four boys of Rama, Bharata, Lakshmana and Shatrughna, they all got married at that great arena or at that great assembly. Such was the great marriage that the Acharyas mention and the Acharyas speak, that if somebody needs to speak about Sita Kalyanam, they can at least take 100 lives to explain what was the beauty of that marriage. That marriage was par excellence. Even the demigods want to attend that marriage. If you have ever got that invitation to that marriage, you don't want to see any other scene in your life, because that was that beautiful. What can we do justice for a 1 hour lecture on Sita Kalyanam? This is the most beautiful rendition that had happened. Both the great personalities, and Lakshmana was married to Sumitra, and these was the great personalities who actually came together for witnessing the marriage. And in fact, this whole marriage ceremony is mentioned very greatly by Tyagaraja. In fact, if anybody of you have attended the South Indian marriages, they constantly sing this glory of none other than Tyagaraja. In fact, Tyagaraja said a very beautiful verse where he said, "In my heart, I create this mandap. My heart is like the mandap where I actually create it with different pillars, and I ensure the foundation is there. My heart is the foundation. And on that, the arteries which are pumping blood are the very pillars of that wedding stage. And the blood which is actually, and those arteries and the veins which are there are actually the decorations on top of that mandap and that heart. And the blood which is flowing is the cool breeze which is flowing into the ashrama. And the holy names are actually the fire or the yajna pit within the heart. And in that mandap, at that place, I am going to place a swing. I am going to place a swing, and I am going to keep Lord Rama and Sita on that swing." Now everything is set. The mandap is set. The fire has been set. The pastimes, the holy names, the sankirtan has been set. Now the swing is also kept. Now what is required? Somebody needs to push the swing. Now he is thinking, who will push this swing? And he was thinking, I am not worth enough to push the swing. This is the quality of a devotee. The devotee never feels, I am capable of doing this activity. He feels, I cannot push this swing, and he takes a step back. And when he takes a step back, his shoulder hits the shoulder of a very great person who is having whitish hair on his shoulder. And he looks back, it is none other than Hanuman holding his hands and standing there. And Tyagaraja says, look, I am not capable of swinging this. Hanuman says, if you are not capable, I am also not capable. But we want to swing the divine couple of Lord Ramchandra and Mother Sita in this swing. So what should be the beautiful arrangement that we should do? What is the beautiful arrangement that we should do in such a way that we bring this quality that they both enjoy this swing very, very nicely? So Hanuman also says, and also Tyagaraja says, they both mention this fact that let us do one thing, and both swing them together. And this scene was seen by everybody else. Lakshmana was there, his mother Sumitra was there, his wife Urmila was there. So seems like some people are mentioning, if I mistakenly spoke about Lakshmana's wife was Sumitra, I'm sorry, it was Urmila. So it was Urmila's marriage to Lakshmana, Mandavi to Bharata, and Shrutakirti to Shatrughna. Thanks for pointing that out. Might be a slip of the tongue, I'm very sorry. But yes, Urmila and Lakshmana, they were all witnessing the scene. And Tyagaraja is beautifully saying this wonderful, wonderful shlokas, this wonderful kirtanas of how Hanuman and him are actually pushing this beautiful swing which is made. Let us just hear those few shlokas and let us hear those pastimes. And with that, let us keep in our core of the hearts this beautiful scene of Rama and Mother Sita getting married and this marriage culminating together. And let us imagine this entire pastime and let us go to sleep today so that we relive in those pastimes that this marriage is happening as we go about. So with that, we will come to an end to Balakanda. But let us first hear the beautiful shlokas of Tyagaraja, who sings this in a very wonderful way.
Pavanaja stuti patra pavana charitra ravi soma pavanetra ramaniya gatra sita kalyana vaibhogame rama kalyana vaibhogame bhakta jana paripala bharita sharaja bhukti mukti dalila bhudeva pala pamara sura bhima paripurna kama shama jagadabhirama saketa dhama sita kalyana vaibhogame.
So like this, he is wonderfully swinging the swing where he is actually singing that Pavanajasuta, who is none other than Hanuman, is pushing the swing along with me. And let that glorious couple called Lord Rama and Mother Sita be married again and again in front of our eyes. Let there be all auspiciousness in this world. Let there be all greatness in this world. With that, this beautiful scene, let us come to a close. Thank you for joining us wonderfully for so many days on this Balakanda and Uttarakanda, which we both saw today very successfully. With that scene, let's come to a conclusion. The next time we meet in a couple of days, we will start with the next kanda, which is called as the Ayodhya Kanda. So I request everyone to join again, and I request anybody who is having questions or comments, please, you can discuss. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Mangala Shasana Parai Madacharya Purogamai Sarvai Acharya Satkridayastu Mangalam. Mangalam Kosalendraya Maganiya Gunaptane Chakravati Tanujaya Sarvagomaya Mangalam. Srimate Raghuviraya Sedulla Disindabe Rashrajaya Nadiraya Mangalam Asadhyam Navarendivyam Abhishaktaya Sitayam Raja Di Raja Di Raja Rama Bhadraya Mangalam. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. So if there